WF House presents an unabridged recording of Best Pick by John Dorney, Jessica Regan, and Tom Salinsky, narrated by the authors.
For Mum and Dad, for encouraging a love of story and letting me see all the films I shouldn't have.
For my parents, Maria and Sean, who gave me everything. You are in every line I write. And for the late Kevin Boyle, brother of Fiona, who gave his little sister and her pals access to his VHS library of wonders. We thank you, and we miss you.
For all the people who have introduced me to films I would otherwise never have watched. My parents, Deborah Francis White, Alex McLaren, Jamie DeCourcy, Robert Kahn, and Jason Smith, among many others. And Joe Adamson, Alexander Walker, and David Thompson, only three out of dozens, who showed me that writing about films can be as much of an art as creating them.
The Academy Awards often, some would say usually, get the Best Picture winner wrong. Anyone who's ever seen Driving Miss Daisy can tell you that. But how and why they get it wrong has changed over time, and one of the things that this book does brilliantly is to explain that. Jessica, Tom, and John have boiled down the years of research that went into their expert podcast and produced an entertaining guide to the whole awards picture and the social and cinematic context that birthed it. This is therefore a fascinating snapshot of what Hollywood considers good filmmaking. In the early days, with a very small voting body drawn solely from among the most powerful people in the industry, it clearly reflected the values of Tinseltown itself. Now, with a more diverse votership in terms of age, race, sex, and nationality, it shows an awards body that is trying to become more pluralistic and more representative of filmmaking as a whole, albeit still largely American and Anglophone filmmaking. Unless you're Martin Scorsese and have already seen everything, you're also going to come out of this with a list of films to seek out so that you can catch up with Tom, Jessica, and John. Thanks to them, you'll know which Oscar winners to prioritise and which you can maybe skip entirely. They've done the hard work of assessing the worthy winners and embarrassing misses so that you don't have to sit through all the Oscar-winning films of the 80s. And for that alone, these heroes deserve our undying respect. They even watched Crash on purpose. The sheer depth of knowledge, passion, and research that the Best Pick team have means that you're going to come out the other side armed with a better understanding of film history, and, not for nothing, the knowledge to win any pub quiz going. I was delighted to guest on the podcast, 1942, Mrs. Miniver, not just because it was a pleasure to talk to the team, but because I learned so much from their analysis over the length of the show's run. The Oscars may get it wrong, but this trio is generally right on the money. So how do we put them in charge of the little gold, guys?
Introduction. What do the Oscars mean to you? In the 1930s and 1940s, the ceremony itself was a banquet dinner in a hotel. In the 1950s, it became a lavish televised production. By the 1960s, it was starting to look dated, and yet that doesn't even get us halfway through its life. Today, many people see it as an irrelevance, a fossil of a bygone age, mired in prejudice, unable to find a tone that connects with a younger audience, and always picking the wrong movies. Respectfully, we disagree. Around the world, especially the English-speaking world, movies mean Hollywood. And Hollywood means Oscars. If you love film, then the Oscars still matter. Winning an Oscar can transform a career. And the upside of the Oscars, reserving its highest awards for films that never even dent the top 20 at the box office, is that there are other awards, apart from the purely financial, which help filmmakers like Barry Jenkins, Ava DuVernay, Alfonso Cuarón, Yorgos Lanthimos, Greta Gerwig, and Steve McQueen get their films made, even if that same Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences sometimes gives its top prize to Green Book. So, We don't pretend that the 92 Best Picture winners are the 92 best films ever made. In fact, we only sometimes find that the Academy has picked what we think is the best film of the year. But that list of 92 films is a finite list that permits no arguments. And that's what inspired us. The three of us had always been keen Oscar watchers. For a number of consecutive marches, we'd gathered around the television together near midnight with bowls of popcorn and glasses of wine, followed several hours later by mugs of coffee, to watch lavish production numbers, awkward comedy bits, parades of anonymous technicians winning for sound mixing or visual effects, stalwart campaigners denied their prize yet again, first-timers reduced to tears, people unthanked, names mispronounced, and finally, at the end of the night, a new film added to this very specific list. Gradually, the idea took hold. 92 Best Picture winners. 92 podcast episodes. For each installment, we researched what happened at that year's awards, looked more widely at the world of film, dug into the making of the winner, and sometimes took detours into other films, filmmakers, trends, and genres. Then we watched the film together and gave our verdict. Did the Academy, in our opinion, get it right? It's been a labor of love, and now it's done. The project is complete. But we're proud to have amassed a following, and so we're carrying on, interviewing more film fans, recording our own audio commentaries, comparing different versions of the same material, and digging out more stories from the world of movies. When we recorded the podcast, to keep things interesting, we put all 92 Best Picture winners in a hat and drew them out in a random order. For this book, we've taken all that research and rearranged and rewritten it in a more streamlined form. Rather than go movie by movie in a random order, we go chronologically through the decades, from the 1920s, albeit there weren't many Oscars in those years, to the 2010s. Each chapter starts with Tom Salinsky talking you through the Oscars. Who was in the running and then fell by the wayside? Whose over-the-top publicity campaign nauseated the viewers? Which film was eliminated because of an arcane change in the rules? Whose acceptance speech created waves in the days to come? Following that, Jessica Regan surveys the decade in film. What new innovations were created to solve particular filmmaking problems? What political forces hemmed in creative minds? What was seen for the first time and the last? And then John Dorney picks the film whose backstory is most typical, most extraordinary, most unlikely, or just most interesting, before we give our views in detail about, first, the Best Picture winner that, for us, represents the very best that the decade's winners have to offer, and then the one that comes, as some film inevitably must, 10th out of 10. In some cases, this isn't a particularly bad film, but as we made our way through Best Picture history, there were some real surprises, and not all of them were pleasant. And that brings us to what, in many ways, was the thought that inspired the whole project. Did the Academy get it right? Each of us has our say on every winner from that decade, either endorsing the choice made by the Oscar voters or giving you our own pick instead. You probably won't agree with all our choices. In fact, you certainly won't, as we don't always agree with each other. But maybe there will be some films we single out that you haven't seen. And what a glorious thing that is, to settle down and watch a film, maybe a film made before even your parents were born, for the very first time. We've had a wonderful time making this podcast and a splendid time writing this book. We hope, when we offer criticism, that we do so fairly and cogently. And above all, we hope our love of cinema shines through these pages. A pedantic note about years. Most Academy Awards shows take place in the spring following the eligibility year. This creates an ambiguity, because the phrase 1975 Oscars could refer to the 47th ceremony, which took place in the spring of 1975, or the 48th ceremony, which celebrated films made in 1975. Throughout this book, we consistently use the second formulation, and when talking about the Oscars, the shorthand in 1975 means at the 48th Academy Awards, which celebrated films made in 1975. The ceremonies whose eligibility period includes two calendar years, we've used the latter of the 2 years, because using the earlier of the 2 years would mean there wasn't a 1933 Oscars. Chapter 1. The 1920s. The Oscars in the 1920s. It all began because Louis B. Mayer wanted to build a beach house. The year was 1926. Movie making had already become a mature industry, the fourth largest in the United States. Hollywood made around 500 films a year and showed them to a weekly audience of around 100 million people in 23,000 cinemas. And although it had only been around since 1924, MGM was already the biggest and most successful studio of them all. In their first full year, they released Ben-Hur, starring Ramon Navarro. This film cost an incredible $4 million, but it made back more than $10 million, and MGM boss Louis B. Mayer became one of the highest paid executives in the country. He had a wife and teenage daughters, and he wanted a house on the beach in Santa Monica. Because he had any number of architects, carpenters, painters, and set designers already on staff, he asked MGM's head of design, Cedric Gibbons, to draw up the plans and his production manager to come up with a schedule and an estimate. But when these were delivered, Mayer got a nasty shock. It was actually going to be far quicker and cheaper to hire outside labor. This was all thanks to something called the Studio Basic Agreement, a contract made between 9 film companies and 5 trade unions. It was signed following almost 10 years of unrest, and it set minimum rates of pay for the first time. Now installed in his palatial beach house, Mayer started wondering what on earth would happen if writers, directors, and God help us all, actors, started asking for similar protection. Something had to be done. On New Year's Day 1927, Mayer invited 3 close colleagues to lunch to discuss the matter. His guests were actor Conrad Nagel, director Fred Nile, and producer Fred Beeston, and they were all sympathetic to Mayer's plight. What if, Mayer proposed, Hollywood's talent already had a body that could look after their best interests? The other 3 started chipping in with their own ideas. They could form an elite filmmaking club that would be open only to the best of the best. They could have different branches for different professions, maybe an annual dinner. Awards were never mentioned. Mayer loved the idea, and less than 2 weeks later, he was holding a formal dinner at the Ambassador Hotel, where 36 founder members of the International Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences listened as the MGM boss unveiled his plans. He got an enthusiastic reception, and before long, 2 MGM lawyers were hard at work creating a charter for the new body. Awards were never mentioned. A launch banquet for 300 people was held on the 11th of May, 1927. Hosted by newly installed Academy President Douglas Fairbanks Sr. At its close, the Academy's membership had increased by 230 people, all of whom paid the $100 joining fee. A few weeks later, the new organisation, now shorn of the international part of its name, published a statement of aims. Among these, for the first time, there was a brief reference to awards of merit for distinctive achievements. But nothing was done at this stage to bring them into existence. Before very long, the Academy was called upon to referee a dispute between studios and talent groups. Maybe not surprisingly, for a body created by a producer, and half of whose founder members were producers, it sided with the studios, proposing an across-the-board pay cut that would have been near meaningless for top executives, but crippling for bit part players. The debacle hurt the newly formed Academy's hoped-for reputation as an impartial mediating body. Mayer had to do something to keep his new organisation relevant. So thoughts turned back to those awards of merit. In theory, a committee to establish these had been set up in May 1927, but it wasn't until June 1928 that this group had anything to show for itself. Gradually, the structure of the awards began to emerge. Members would vote for their preferred people or films in different categories. Counting the votes would generate shortlists of nominees. The winners would then be decided by a central board of judges, one from each of the Academy's five branches: actors, writers, producers, directors, and technicians. Cedric Gibbons had sketched out a possible look for the awards during one of those early committee meetings. The design was refined by his assistant, Frederick Hope, who added the five slots in the reel of film that forms the base of the statuette, one for each of the Academy's branches. Modern awards have 12 slots. The California Bronze Foundry won the job of producing them. Nominees, or honourable mentions as they were called, were to receive scrolls. Ballots were sent out, filled, and returned. Finally, in February 1929, the Central Board of Judges was ready to decide the winners. Charlie Chaplin's The Circus was eligible, and it had been a huge hit. But late in the day, the Academy decided to revoke all four of Chaplin's nominations and instead grant him an honorary award. In a letter to Chaplin, the Academy attempted to explain that this was not a slight, but an indication that he was in a class all his own. Charlie Chaplin's response is not recorded. The Academy had also decided that the jazz singer should not be eligible for Best Picture, as its gimmick of synchronized dialogue gave it an unfair advantage. With the nominations now down to two in four categories, the judges began to deliberate. The five people who were supposed to be picking the winners had selected the MGM film The Crowd for the Best Unique and Artistic Picture Award. But Louis B. Mayer announced that he was going to supervise the process, and he argued passionately against a film from his own studio. He privately disliked King Vidor's domestic drama, which hadn't made much money, but more importantly, he wanted the Academy Awards to maintain the appearance of impartiality. Sunrise, released by Fox, and directed by a foreigner who was not a member of the Academy, suited his purpose far better, and he eventually prevailed. In the end, Sunrise received three awards, while the World War I aerial combat drama Wings won Outstanding Picture and Best Engineering Effects. The following year, various categories were scrapped, including Best Unique and Artistic Picture. It seems fairly clear that the original intent was to create two equal Best Picture categories. But several years later, it was decided that Outstanding Picture was the same as Best Picture, and that Sunrise had won some other award. Ironically, it is Sunrise whose reputation has endured. It came in seventh in the 2002 Sight and Sound poll, and fifth in 2012. The results of all this voting and wrangling were printed on the back page of the Academy Bulletin a few days later. A full 3 months after that, a ceremony was staged at the Roosevelt Hotel. It took barely 15 minutes to hand out the awards, followed by dinner and dancing. How on earth did this modest-sounding event become the most prestigious in the entire show business calendar? Well, one person we have to thank is press baron William Randolph Hearst, famously parodied by Orson Welles in Citizen Kane. Hearst took note of the first Academy Awards and realized that if these were to become tremendously important, then he might be able to arrange matters so that his mistress, movie actor Marion Davies, could win one. Accordingly, he instructed columnist Luella Parsons to lavish every superlative she could muster in her write-up of the ceremony. Accordingly, when the second event rolled around, expectations had been raised. Another person who had her eye on matters transpiring at the Roosevelt Hotel was silent star Mary Pickford. Pickford's career was in trouble. In 1916, she'd been one of the biggest box office stars in the world and had full authority over the pictures she appeared in. In 1919, she formed United Artists with Charlie Chaplin, D.W. Griffith, and her husband Douglas Fairbanks. However, she struggled with the transition to sound. Her first talkie, Coquette, while not a complete flop, failed to make much of an impact. Her second sound film, The Taming of the Shrew, with Fairbanks as Petruchio, was a disaster. But Pickford saw a way out. According to the newspapers, the Hearst papers anyway, these new Academy Awards were a big deal. She invited the Central Board of Judges to pick fair mansions and wined and dined them. Taming of the Shrew was outside the eligibility period for the second Academy Awards, maybe for the best, but Pickford nevertheless won Best Actress for Coquette, a film very few people saw and hardly anybody liked. Sadly for Pickford, the strategy didn't work. She'd appeared in more than 200 silent films, but she only made two more talkies before retiring from acting in 1933. She remained active as a producer until 1949 and was given an honorary Academy Award in 1975, 4 years before her death. Marion Davies, an accomplished comic actor, was forced into unsuitable dramatic roles by Hearst, and she retired from film acting in 1937 without a single Academy Award nomination to her name. Mary Pickford's method of steering the voting in her direction cast significant doubt on the integrity of the Academy. So for the third awards, the now 600-odd members of the Academy voted within their branches to decide nominations, and the entire Academy voted on the winners, essentially the same procedure in use today. But this didn't stop Norma Shearer, married at the time to MGM's head of production Irving G. Thalberg, from triumphing over hot favourite Greta Garbo to pinch Best Actress. Joan Crawford, who would have to wait until 1946 for her first nomination, commented dryly, "What do you expect? She sleeps with the boss." Adding to the incestuous feel was the fact that the new award for sound recording went to Douglas Shearer, brother of Norma, for the MGM production The Big House, which also scored a win for Francis Marion, who wrote the screenplay. And it was Louis B. Mayer himself who presented producer Carl Laemmle with his Best Picture Award for All Quiet on the Western Front, telling him he thought it might win a Nobel Peace Prize. Laemmle described the event as the proudest moment of his life, next to the thrill of becoming a grandfather. It would be decades before the Academy Awards were televised, but portions of these awards were reenacted for movie cameras at some later point. History doesn't record exactly when this happened or whose idea it was, but the footage was spliced into newsreels and it features Carl Laemmle, Norma Shearer and Francis Marion accepting their awards. The entire film runs for 7.5 minutes and you can see the whole thing on YouTube. Not included in this footage are the two guests of honour. Once the dancing and banqueting was over, Hollywood's censor-in-chief Will Hayes rose to his feet and lectured those present for almost an hour about how important it was for the movie industry's financial fortunes for them also to be guardians of public taste and morality. And Thomas Edison was given an honorary award for his pioneering efforts in early film technology. He did not appear in person, but he did provide a short film in which he offered his thanks, something you can bet Steven Soderbergh would never have allowed.
The movies in the 1920s. cinema was but a few decades young and rapidly developing. Since its beginnings as a sideshow novelty, it had gone from capturing snippets of reality to longer narrative features with large casts, elaborate sets, trick photography, and detailed storylines. This flourishing of the medium was greatly facilitated by the establishment of two simple but transformational practices: having a production schedule and preparing a continuity script. The centre of activity for movie making had shifted from New York to California. Hollywood's combination of near constant sunshine and varied topography made for very favourable shooting conditions. All that was needed now was a commercial structure that could take advantage of these golden opportunities. Enter the studio system. Theatre owners Adolf Zukor, Louis B. Mayer, and Jack, Harry, and Sam Warner came to Hollywood from America's Northeast. In running their theatres, they realised that showing films was more lucrative than hiring live acts. But there wasn't enough product being generated to satisfy the demand. So these five men went west and founded studios that are still in existence today. Together with Daryl F. Zanuck, who began by working with the brothers Warner, they founded Paramount Pictures, Zukor, Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, Mayer, Warner Brothers Pictures, and 20th Century Fox, Zanuck. RKO was founded by David Sarnoff in 1928, completing the quintet known as the Big Five. The heads of these studios were responsible for every aspect of the movie-making process and all the steps in the supply chain. They chose the script, approved the budget, hired the actors, supervised the edit, and finally distributed the finished film to the movie theatres, many of which they owned either partly or outright. Key to the success of these films was the emphasis on star actors, and nobody did more to develop and commercialise the audience's relationships with star actors than MGM's head of production, Irving Thalberg. A precocious talent, he began at Universal, still a teenager, and he was only 20 when studio chief Carl Laemmle left him to negotiate a new bank loan to keep the struggling studio afloat. Thalberg got the loan, but was unable to legally sign the paperwork, as he was still technically underage. His ability with story and character was amazing, and his understanding of stars' personas was years ahead of his contemporaries. At Universal, he realised that Lon Chaney was a major talent, but that his gallery of grotesques weren't winning him an audience. He mandated that future films had to include a moment of redemption for Chaney's character, and in doing so, he turned a character actor into a star. Was it formula? Yes, if you like, but a hugely successful one. At 24, he became co-owner of MGM, essentially running the studio alongside Louis B. Mayer. He was hugely influential in shaping how movies were being made. He organised story conferences, held sneak previews for films, and had scenes reshot if the audience feedback wasn't good enough. In 1929, MGM released 50 films. 45 of them were profitable. However, he was born with a congenital heart condition, and doctors had warned him he wouldn't live past 30. He died in September 1936 at the age of 37. One reason you might not have heard his name before is that it doesn't appear in any of the dozens of movies he produced. Louis B. Mayer always had his name in the titles, but Thalberg felt that credit you give yourself is not worth having. His final film, released after he died, was The Good Earth, which won numerous Academy Awards. Its opening screen credit was a dedication to Thalberg. What the movies that made Thalberg's early career didn't have, of course, was synchronized sound. Not because the idea had never occurred to anyone. In fact, Thomas Edison had been showing minute-long films with sound to audiences in New York as early as 1894. But these were viewed by customers who peered into individual booths, and by the mid-1920s, the big money was in projection systems and large auditoriums. The technology already existed to record sound on records. That same Thomas Edison had patented the phonograph in 1878. But many feature films ran more than an hour, and records could only hold 3 or so minutes of audio. And even if you solved that problem, how could you amplify the recording to the point where it could fill a large theatre? And how could you keep the spinning record synchronised with the film projector? It took decades for these issues to be tackled, and even then, the studios were slow to react. By 1925, at least two separate systems for making sound films had been developed, and were being used to show newsreels and other shorts in a small number of American cities. But the Big Five saw no reason to massively disrupt their current highly profitable industry. Adding sound would mean reinventing their business model from scratch. New equipment both on set and in theatres, new approaches to filmmaking and storytelling, a much bigger problem with overseas sales, difficulties for popular stars who weren't used to dialogue, and so on. Finally, in 1926, Warner Brothers broke ranks. They invested heavily in the Vitaphone sound-on-disc system, envisaging a world in which their silent pictures could be shipped to movie theatres with records containing music and sound effects, thus saving the cost of a piano player or orchestra. In August 1926, Warner Brothers released the first ever feature-length film with synchronized sound, Don Juan, starring John Barrymore. At the lavish premiere, they also showed a handful of shorts, all of them with synchronized music and sound effects, and one film that captured a speech by Censor-in-Chief Will Hayes. This was the only item in the running order to include any dialogue. After the huge financial success of Don Juan, Warner Brothers announced that all their productions from now on were going to include sound. Still using the sound-on-disc process, although by now there were around a half dozen competing systems to choose from, they pumped out four more Vitaphone films in the next 12 months, all with synchronized music and sound effects. And then, in October 1927, they released The Jazz Singer, starring Al Jolson as Jakey Rabinowitz, the cantor's son who becomes a singing star under the name Jack Robin. And audiences went crazy. This was conceived as another silent film with Vitaphone synchronized music, but it contains Al Jolson singing six songs and about 2 minutes of dialogue, including the famous line, "Wait a minute, you ain't heard nothing yet," which was already a Jolson catchphrase. Watching the film today, it seems very odd that it keeps switching from synchronized singing to silent movie title cards, but if anything, this only seemed to increase the audience's appetite for talkies. The very presence of the silent scenes made them miss the talking scenes all the more. Suddenly, the silent era was over. During the next 2 years, Hollywood movie making was reinvented from the ground up at a total cost of around $300 million, almost four times the value of the entire industry. But the studios had no option. The market for silent pictures had entirely dried up. Almost nobody who released a silent movie in the whole of 1927 made a profit from it. It was sound or nothing. Bigger companies invested from their own profits or borrowed the money they needed from Wall Street. Smaller companies were forced to close. It didn't matter that these early talkies were very crude and clumsy compared to their silent counterparts. Silent film was dead and buried. And it wasn't just in America that change swept the industry. The following year in the United Kingdom, Alfred Hitchcock directed the first British talkie, Blackmail, which was another huge hit. The enormous profits from sound films enabled the big Hollywood studios to pay back their investors and ride out the Great Depression. At the first Academy Awards, 25 films received nominations. 24 of them were silent. At the second Academy Awards, 28 films received nominations. Only 7 were silent, and another 6 were partially silent. By the third ceremony, one documentary film had only music and sound effects, and every other nominated film was a talkie. Fairly quickly, the Vitaphone sound-on-disc system, which had been the choice of the Big Five, was abandoned. Although Vitaphone offered excellent audio quality compared to sound-on-film systems, the system was fiddly to say the least. With a new disc for each 10-minute reel of film, each of which had to be carefully queued up in the time it took the previous reel to play through, and The Jazz Singer, for example, was 15 reels. Discs also wore out fast and could easily be damaged in transit. As the audio quality improved, sound-on-film systems, with either optical or magnetic sound strips on the edge of the celluloid, became the norm. This also meant that motion picture film became standardized at 24 frames per second. Cameras used to be hand-cranked, and the frame rate could vary wildly. While acceptable for silent films with improvised live music, this couldn't work with recorded sound. Film stock wasn't cheap, and the rate of 24 was deemed to be the best compromise between creating a satisfactory level of realistic motion without burning through miles of expensive celluloid. Modern cinema had arrived. Some stars managed the transition to sound without issue. Familiar names who began their careers in the silent era include William Powell, Janet Gaynor, Greta Garbo, John Barrymore, Joan Crawford, and Laurel and Hardy. The trio of silent clowns who today are the best remembered aspect of silent cinema all struggled in different ways. Harold Lloyd was a comfortable public speaker, and he had some hits in the sound era, but remaking his thrill pictures like Safety Last, in which he clambers up the outside of a skyscraper, was a disaster. What was a brilliantly comical depiction of high-stakes jeopardy with only piano accompaniment turned out to be horrifying when the hero's cries of distress regularly punctuated the action. The box office failure of The General, now seen as a masterpiece, forced Buster Keaton to take a contract at MGM, who had no idea what to do with him, and so he faded from view. Although his output slowed, Charlie Chaplin continued to be a major force in American movies, stubbornly making dialogue-free films throughout the 1930s. But he eventually retired his little tramp character and never again achieved the level of success he had enjoyed in his heyday. A lot of movies in this period are hybrids of one kind or another. All Quiet on the Western Front was released in both sound and silent versions. Blackmail, mentioned earlier, began as a silent film and was hastily converted to sound. And plenty of major stars weren't able to sustain their careers for a variety of reasons. The likes of Clara Bow, Emil Jannings, Ramon Navarro, John Gilbert and Mary Pickford, who had once ruled the box office, were no longer able to draw crowds. Pretty much the only star in Hollywood who didn't worry about what this new technology would mean was Rin Tin Tin. Provided the microphones could pick up his barking, he was happy.
The Making of Wings. Wings was written by Hope Loring, Louis D. Lighton, John Monk Saunders and Julian Johnson. It was directed by William A. Wellman and produced by B.P. Schulberg, Adolf Zucker, for famous players Lasky and Paramount. The cast included Clara Bow, Charles Buddy Rogers, Richard Arlen and Gary Cooper. At the Oscars, it won Outstanding Picture and Best Engineering Effects for Roy Pomeroy. It's 111 minutes long. Its budget was $2 million. Its box office was $3.6 million, and its Rotten Tomatoes score is 93%. Wings starts off with John Monk Saunders, a man born in 1897 in Minnesota. A gifted student, he went to Oxford as a Rhodes Scholar, where he hung out with John Masefield and Rudyard Kipling, before joining the Air Force during World War I and serving as a flight instructor in Florida. He was desperate to be involved in the fighting in France, but he was never sent, and was bitterly disappointed, weeping on the wing of his plane on the night of the armistice. This frustration lingered with him for the rest of his life. While working as a reporter in New York, he started to sell short stories to magazines and began to crave literary fame and the wealth that came with it. In 1924, he sold the rights for one short story to famous players Lasky Pictures, later Paramount, and so was introduced to Hollywood. Then, in 1926, they also bought his unfinished novel about World War I pilots, Wings, for $39,000. This was the highest sum paid for film rights at the time, well over $500,000 in 2021 money. The production was equally huge. Most films in those days took a month to shoot. Wings took 9. It had a budget of $2 million and was shot between the 7th of September 1926 and the 8th of April 1927. The director selected for the film was William A. Wellman. Wellman had started in the business as an actor, but hated it, and soon moved to directing, mainly making B pictures. He was an unlikely choice for the film, but he was the only director in Hollywood at the time with combat pilot experience. He'd flown in France during the war, won the Croix de Guerre, had 3 recorded kills of enemy craft, and had once been shot down, leading to a lifelong limp. Despite all this, his lack of experience making big movies did lead to a reduced fee. Major directors would usually get $175,000 for a film, but he got a mere $250 a week. Authenticity was the watchword. Leading men Richard Arlen and Buddy Rogers both flew their own planes. Arlen had flown in World War I and Rogers underwent flight training, logging more than 800 hours of flying time so that he, like Arlen, could be filmed in close-up in the air. Most of the time, they not only assumed the flying duties but also operated the camera themselves, as the cockpits were only big enough for one person. The actors would get the plane in the air, fly it, film themselves, and then land, acting all the time. Getting used to this took time, and they needed more pilots and more planes. Seeing it as a great recruiting tool, the US military was happy to help, sending in thousands of soldiers and almost all of their pursuit planes. This drive for authenticity didn't always make for efficient filmmaking. Wellman needed clouds in the sky to give the plane scale, so he couldn't film on clear days, leading to a 4-week delay. But the studio's loss was a gain for the cast, who thoroughly enjoyed their downtime staying together at the St. Anthony Hotel. By the time of their departure, after 9 months, all the elevator girls were reportedly pregnant. According to Wellman, leading lady Clara Bow, the original It girl after her success in the movie It, had relationships of some kind with actors Arlen and Rogers, three pilots, and a writer, and began an affair with the then unknown Gary Cooper. She certainly had a better time at the hotel than in the film, where she felt her part was only set dressing. Eventually, Wellman got everything in the can, taking 6 weeks to finish the editing and dedicating the film to those young warriors of the sky whose wings are folded about them forever. It was a huge hit when it premiered in August 1927, running for more than a year. This didn't, however, lead to lasting success for John Monk Saunders. After the triumph of Wings, he became a full-time screenwriter and married King Kong star Faye Ray, but it turns out that the giant ape wasn't the biggest monster in her life. He had multiple affairs, was accused of plagiarism, got addicted to drink and drugs, and was involved in fistfights at Hollywood parties. It's perhaps not a surprise that he was partially blacklisted, at which point his behaviour got worse. He became vehemently pro-Nazi, was sometimes heard being anti-Semitic, and once surreptitiously injected Ray with a drug and sold off their home and contents and absconded with their child. After their divorce in 1940, it seemed as if he might be turning his life around and kicking his alcohol habit, but he hanged himself at the age of 41. Screenwriter Adela St. Rogers said she thought he was staging his own unhappy ending to a strange, not entirely self-imposed exile from the one place he most wanted to be, which was Hollywood. Wings had a happier ending. The film was thought to be lost completely for many years with no copies known to exist, until 1992, when a print was found in the Cinémathèque Française film archive in Paris, and a spare negative was found in the Paramount vaults. For the film's restoration, the original score was unearthed from the Library of Congress and recreated, meaning we can still enjoy the very first Best Picture winner today.
Best of the Best, All Quiet on the Western Front. This was written by Maxwell Anderson, George Abbott, Del Andrews, C. Gardner Sullivan, based on the novel by Eric Maria Remarque. It was directed by Lewis Milestone and produced by Carl Lamley Jr. for Universal. The cast included Lou Ayres, Louis Wolheim, John Ray, Arnold Lucy, Ben Alexander. It won Best Picture and Best Director. It was nominated for Best Writing, and Arthur Edison was nominated for Best Cinematography. It's 133 minutes long, its budget was $1.2 million, and its box office was $3 million. Its score is 98% on Rotten Tomatoes. This was a book that had been circulated, serialized, and translated to worldwide acclaim. It was one of the first texts to be burned by the Nazis, so you know you're onto a good thing. Its impact meant it was ripe for adaptation, and Hollywood laid claim to it within 2 years of its publication. It certainly rattled some cages. Screenings of the film in Germany were disrupted by the Nazi followers, brown shirts, escalating to attacks on Jewish members of the audience. As noted above, the filmmakers shot it simultaneously as a silent film and as a sound film. This gave it a global reach that it otherwise might not have had. Language wouldn't be a barrier to it being received internationally, as title cards could easily be translated, whereas dubbing was an audio bridge too far. The story follows young Paul Baumer and his contemporaries as they are inspired to join the army by their jingoistic professor, who urges the defending of the fatherland. But they do not find glory or heroism in the trenches, only disease and degradation, and while they can physically come home from the battlefields, their minds never leave the war. The loneliness of knowing you will forevermore be out of place and time, as only your fellow soldiers can begin to know what is in your heart and on your mind, is communicated painfully well in the stilted exchanges and misunderstandings upon his return. Trauma is granular, and it is present in every frame of this film. The loss of the lead protagonist's innocence and idealism becomes a microcosm for what the war did for the world. The technical achievement of this film cannot be overstated. Sound, for all its great leap forward in storytelling possibilities, presented enormous technical difficulties and seemed to set movie making back considerably, particularly in terms of cinematography. This film illustrates how quickly it all got back on track, quite literally, as tracking shots create a marvellous fluidity with an almost Fincher-esque flourish near the beginning. The brilliantly staged battle sequences are initially impressive, but truthfully transmute into something a great deal more harrowing and relentless. The sounds of shelling and bombardment become interminable, jangling the nerves of the viewer. It is a superb use of this new technology, using audio to engage empathy with the soldier's pitiful situation as much as any character could. The constraints the production was working under are hard to fathom by our modern-day standards. There was no CGI, barely any post-production, and yet shot after shot is mesmeric, and nothing feels awkward or strained. Spielberg has stated that this film was a major influence on Saving Private Ryan, but where Spielberg cannot help but go for the bravura shot, and other war films can seem to revel in the gore, Hacksaw Ridge, I'm looking at you, director Lewis Milestone shows a somber restraint, particularly with the ending. It is stark and earned, and as the soundtrack cuts completely, we are alone in the silence left by the absence of life. This is a film that is a great deal more visceral and technically dazzling than it has any need to be, considering it is almost a century old. It is emotively edited and sincerely acted, with a production design that recreates tiny hovels as faithfully as battlefields or a rustic boudoir. Every department triumphs in the telling of this tragedy. The author of the book, Eric Maria Remarque, prefaces it with, "This book is to be neither an accusation nor a confession, and least of all an adventure, for death is not an adventure to those who stand face to face with it. It will try simply to tell of a generation of men who, even though they may have escaped its shells, were destroyed by the war." I cannot imagine a film made at this time, or at any time in fact, that could have realised that simple intention better.
Worst of the best, The Broadway Melody. This film was written by Edmund Goulding, Sarah Y. Mason, Norman Houston, and James Gleason, with songs by Nacho Herb Brown and Arthur Freed, and also Willard Robeson. The director was Harry Beaumont. The producers were Irving Thalberg and Lawrence Weingarten for MGM. The cast includes Charles King, Anita Page, Bessie Love, and Jed Prouty. At the Academy Awards, it won Best Picture and was nominated for Best Director and Bessie Love for Best Actress. It runs 100 minutes, it cost $379,000, and it took $4.4 million at the box office. It has a Rotten Tomatoes score of 35%. Like anything else, the Hollywood musical took a while to perfect. On Broadway, in 1927, Oscar Hammerstein and Jerome Kern had revolutionised the form with Showboat, in which all of the songs developed characters or advanced the plot rather than just being standalone showcases. But it wasn't until the early 1930s that movies began to take full advantage of the new medium. One often overlooked film is the charming Love Me Tonight from 1932, starring Maurice Chevalier and directed by Ruben Mamoulian. As the film opens, young Parisian Taylor Chevalier begins singing the film's signature song, Isn't It Romantic, to one of his clients. As the song develops, it is picked up by the client, who strolls out of the shop singing it. He passes it on to a taxi driver until eventually half of Paris is joining in. This was revolutionary. Constructing a musical sequence in the edit and across multiple locations in a way that could never be replicated on the stage. Suddenly, all of those earlier movie musicals looked confined, old-fashioned, and limited. So the Broadway melody finds itself trapped between two innovations. Synchronized sound has come to the movies, and for a year or two at least, just the fact that popular stars can talk and sing and live in an oral world is enough for many movie fans. But the coming of sound brings endless technical challenges, and so the years 1928 to 1930 are virtually a nadir in terms of visual sophistication. Wings has cinematic flair to burn. The Broadway melody looks like it was made in 1900, as directors and crew struggle just trying to capture moving images and live sound at the same time. It doesn't help that this effort is saddled with a story that barely qualifies as anything other than a series of set pieces, most of which involve renditions of the title song. Backstage musicals live or die by their ability to instill in the audience the sense of urgency that stars, dancers, backers, producers, and their loved ones feel about the success of the production they're all involved in. But the characters here are so thinly drawn that it's hard to get terribly invested in their petty concerns. In the best movie musicals, the song and dance numbers emerge organically from the emotions of the characters, creating heart-stopping moments simply not available to non-musical stories. In plenty of merely very good musicals, a few excellent show-stopping numbers make up for deficiencies in the plotting and characterization. Here, it's frustrating when the poorly staged numbers stop the plot dead in its tracks. But the plot is so banal that very quickly I start longing for another song to break it up. There are some standout routines, but none of them are from the stars. Bessie Love was an accomplished dancer, but co-star Anita Page rather less so, and it's painfully obvious in many sections that the choreography was designed around this constraint. However, some of the speciality acts in the last third are genuinely eye-popping, including a tap dance en point that would put Sid Charisse or Leslie Caron to shame. It feels churlish to blame Harry Beaumont, Irving Thalberg and company for failing to innovate sooner, or for labouring under the weight of unprecedented technical challenges. But the fact remains that there are a great many other films from this period that are more charming, make better use of the resources available, and generally make for a more engaging viewing experience. It helps to view movies from this era kindly and with expectations tempered. What's disappointing about the Broadway melody is that even through this lens, it's a bit of a letdown. Worth seeing as a proto-version of all those backstage musicals to come, it's easy to see the roots of far better films like 42nd Street here. But even compared to other musical films made the same year, this seems both flimsy and creaky.
Did the Academy get it right? 1927 to 1928. Wings. The Oscars are born as the silent era dies, but this means that the awarded movies are the pinnacle of this style of filmmaking. The sheer technical achievement of Wings is not to be overstated, with its dizzying, vertiginous dogfights the obvious star turn. But the movie still manages to tell a strong, surprising story that's all the more tense for key set pieces being shot for real. It's not a film you can just sit down and watch, sure, but if you put in the effort, it rewards you emphatically. The first winner of Best Picture is a thoroughly deserving recipient.
Unquestionably, every single choice in this film is made in the pursuit of artistic excellence, from the sage, characterful title cards to the bravura tracking shot that traverses several tables in a Parisian cafe, telling us in seconds the situations of several of its patrons. It is staggering to consider that this film is nearly 100 years old. But the true star of Wings is the camera work. Swooping and soaring, it catches every thrilling beat of the air battles. It is an extraordinary feeling to watch an epic action sequence and realise nearly a century later that it could hardly be improved on. Even Fritz Lang's visionary and highly influential Metropolis doesn't give me pause. The Academy got it right the first time.
The Academy begins as it means to go on, for the next 50 or so years at least. Wings is real blockbuster entertainment. Rarely subtle, but powerful, bombastic, brilliantly staged, and even moving at times. This is a year when the great silent clowns were all a little under par. Chaplin's The Circus is vastly overshadowed by the masterpieces either side of it. Harold Lloyd's Speedy is a bit undisciplined, following the excellent The Kid Brother the year before. And Keaton's Steamboat Bill Jr. takes forever to get going before an admittedly crackerjack climax. So it's the dramas I'm drawn to, especially the heartbreaking The Last Command, probably my favourite film from this 12-month span. But if I were an Academy voter in 1928, I would have given The Last Command Best Unique and Artistic Picture, and I would have given Outstanding Picture to Wings.
1928 to 1929, The Broadway Melody. It's the first talkie to win Best Picture, and is pretty much the first movie musical, and so has a reasonable claim to being the best picture of its year, even if it's more than slightly dull when watched over 90 years after it was made. But one of this year's films that isn't dull in the least is The Passion of Joan of Arc. It's a difficult watch in every sense, with the inherent problems of watching a silent movie to overcome before you even get to the brutal content. But it is completely mesmerizing and, if you can stomach it, it's a true work of art.
Ah, the awkward but necessary transitional winner between the pinnacle of silent film and the new adventures in sound. Throw in some off-colour jokes, even allowing for the time, and a deeply sleazy leading man who is not much better than his Jack Warner surrogate nemesis, and as a viewing experience, it is an uphill slog. I will admit that Bessie Love breaking down in her dressing room as her life falls apart in a matter of minutes is an island of truth in a sea of artifice. But this year, my heart belongs to The Fall of the House of Usher, an exquisitely gothic, haunting visual poem that is as impressive as it is transportive.
As noted earlier, the rush to create talkies in the wake of The Jazz Singer meant that very little Hollywood product was of a super high calibre around this time. A few European filmmakers blended silent and sound techniques with more skill, and there were one or two silent-era holdouts. Buster Keaton's last silent film, and his first for MGM, is one of his finest. Given a lavish MGM budget, Keaton goes to town. But after this, the studio reined him in, and soon he was reduced to bit parts and gag writing for other comedy stars. Nevertheless, for years afterwards, MGM bosses would show new writers, directors, and stars this film as an object lesson in how to make a comedy. The Cameraman is my pick, from a rather creaky collection.
1929 to 1930. All Quiet on the Western Front. All Quiet on the Western Front is a brutal watch, the great grandfather of later war films like Saving Private Ryan. A movie made between the wars with the Germans as the heroes, it left me feeling shell-shocked like no other, with an ambition and power far ahead of its time. A very worthy winner indeed.
It is notable for being a story of war told from a German soldier's perspective. It is precious for being made a little more than a decade from the time of the events it depicts. But its importance as a historical document is not the reason it should have won. It is simply an excellent film, a devastating watch, and a truthful, moving portrait of the young men of World War I who came back dead or not really alive from the atrocities they witnessed. All Quiet on the Western Front sets the bar for Best Picture winners and war films, and cinema in general, commendably high.
It's an old story, war is hell, that filmmakers keep on telling. There's a clear artistic line that connects this film to Sam Mendes' 1917 via Paths of Glory, Apocalypse Now, Platoon, and countless others. But there are a few elements which have never been captured quite as clearly as they are here. A compassionate and detailed evocation of a haunting book, All Quiet on the Western Front, comprehensively proves that early talkies have much more to offer than overhead shots of dozens of anonymous dancers and bloodless gangster slayings. Chapter 2, The 1930s. The Oscars in the 1930s. Throughout the 1930s, the Academy Awards, as we know them, gradually emerged, while the Academy itself fought for its identity and existence. One of the first things to change was that someone eventually decided that having the awards straddle two calendar years was cumbersome and confusing. To regularise this, the 6th Academy Awards were held a full 16 months after the previous event, making 1933 the only calendar year since the Academy Awards were created that no ceremony was held. It was at this ceremony that Walt Disney, accepting the award for Best Short Subject Cartoon, became the first person on the Academy stage to refer to the statuette as an Oscar. The origins of this nickname are the subject of much debate, but it was obviously already in common use by this time. During the 16-month gap between ceremonies, the Academy had been intervening in Hollywood labour disputes, generally without much success, and it had faced accusations of a monopoly as Roosevelt tried to lift America out of the Great Depression. Uncertain that the Academy had their best interests at heart, a group of actors quit to form the Screen Actors Guild in July 1933, the one thing that Academy founder Louis B. Mayer had been hoping to prevent. They joined forces with the Screen Writers Guild to publish a monthly magazine, and by August, their membership was more than 1,000, while membership of the Academy was severely reduced as a consequence. The other change, during this long gap, was that prohibition had been repealed. The ban on alcohol in the United States had been in force since 1920, and it ended on the 5th of December 1933, making the 6th Oscars the first where you could have a drink. One person who might have needed to take advantage of this new freedom was Columbia's star director, Frank Capra. Capra had become consumed with thoughts of Oscar success and was convinced that Lady for a Day would win all 4 Oscars for which it was nominated, which would set a record. It didn't win for its writing or Best Actress, but it was still in the running for Best Picture and Capra for Best Director. MC Will Rogers opened the Best Director envelope and said the following words. "Well, well, well, what do you know? I've watched this young man for a long time. Saw him come up from the bottom, and I mean the bottom. It couldn't happen to a nicer guy. Come on up and get it, Frank." Capra leapt out of his seat and began to make his way to the front as the audience erupted in delighted applause. His long journey to the stage was hampered by the fact that the spotlight seemed to have trouble finding him. "Over here!" he yelled jubilantly, waving his arms. Finally, the spotlight found its target. On the other side of the room, Frank Lloyd, the director of Cavalcade, was bathed in light as he bounded onto the platform and Rogers handed him the Oscar. Capra returned to his seat, taking what he describes in his autobiography as the longest, saddest, most shattering walk in my life. I wished I could have crawled under the rug like a miserable worm. Capra's humiliation didn't last very long. At the 1934 awards, his film It Happened One Night made a clean sweep of Best Picture, Best Director, Best Screenplay, Best Actor, and Best Actress. But that wasn't the way the evening was supposed to go. Betty Davis was widely expected to be nominated for her role in Of Human Bondage, which Life magazine called probably the best performance ever recorded on screen by a US actress. So there was outrage when the nominations were announced and Davis had been overlooked completely. Part of the issue for Davis was that she was under contract at Warner Brothers, but had been loaned out to RKO for this movie. RKO didn't want to campaign for her to win Best Actress because they wouldn't benefit from her increased profile. And Warner Brothers didn't want to give free publicity to a film made by a rival studio. The whole debacle probably did end up benefiting Davis at least as much as winning would have, maybe even more. but also started to raise questions about how the Academy functioned, who its members were, and whether it still had a future. Something had to be done. To quell the unrest, the Academy decided to allow write-in votes for the final ballot. If you didn't like how the nominations turned out, you could write in whichever name you thought was missing. So, many sources list Davis as a nominee this year, but it was only as a result of write-in votes. And in the end, it was Claudette Colbert who won anyway, in a walk, according to MC Irwin S. Cobb, who revealed how the voting had gone at the end of the evening. Davis continued to fume and stew, but following his triumphant win, Frank Capra became not just the darling of the Academy, but also its president. And he was the one who had to figure out how to keep the show on the road as the writers and directors guilds tried to organise a boycott of the next awards. His task was made even harder when the studios, scenting blood, decided that the Academy was finished, so they withdrew their financial support as well. With some cunning, Capra announced that the 1935 awards would be a tribute to legendary director D.W. Griffith. Griffith had only made two talkies and then retired in 1931, but Capra persuaded him to personally attend the ceremony to accept an honorary award. Armed with this news, he began calling the stars and directors of the year's biggest movies to secure their attendance, and then he got Academy staff to give out tickets to assistants, secretaries, interns, and family members to fill any remaining empty seats. It worked. The Oscars went ahead, and even Betty Davis was pleased, managing to win her first Oscar for Dangerous, although she still grumbled to friends that this was a consolation prize and that Of Human Bondage was both a better film and a better performance from her. Also grumbling about his Oscar was Dudley Nichols, who won Best Adapted Screenplay for The Informer. Nichols was not just a screenwriter, he was president of the Screenwriters Guild, the very body attempting to put the Academy out of business. After some tense communications between Nichols and Capra, including the Academy mailing Nichols his statuette and Nichols mailing it right back again, Nichols opted to refuse his award. He thus became the first person ever to decline an Oscar. A couple of years later, when Capra had brokered a peace between the Academy and the guilds, Nichols publicly collected his statuette as a token of the understanding between the two groups. In 1935, three men were nominated as Best Actor for Mutiny on the Bounty: Clark Gable, Charles Laughton, and Franco Tone. None of them won, and partly in response to this, Capra introduced two new awards categories: Best Supporting Actor and Best Supporting Actress. However, for the first 7 years of their existence, people who won in these categories didn't get statuettes, they received only plaques. This may have been connected to another problem that Capra was trying to solve. No longer able to depend on the studios to fund lavish banquet dinners, the Academy was in...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.